السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Welcome dear brothers and sisters to this lecture in أصول حديث الأحكام. We will start with the chapter of Saum while travel, and in this chapter, as I mentioned in the book, there are many narrations. What is the narrations? Yeah, you know why?
Maybe because you
save
it in my
Maybe it's still fasting. This is the main book or the normal book. عمدة الأحكام. This is what we teach. عمدة الأحكام من كلام خير الأنام. من كلام خير الأنام. So chapter 33, باب الصوم في السفر وغيره. The first narration is narration of عائشة رضي الله عنها. She said, حمزة ابن عمرو الأسلمي قال للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أصوم في السفر وكان كثير الصيام فقال إن شئت فصم وإن شئت فأفطر. So عائشة رضي الله عنها narrated that حمزة ابن عمرو الأسلمي رضي الله عنه asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم Shall I fast while I am traveling? And عائشة says حمزة was a person who observing fast throughout the year. So he was known by fasting most of days. The Prophet ﷺ replied, if you want, you can fast. If you want, you can break your fast. So 50-50. So Hamza asked the Prophet ﷺ, of course, because the fact that the rukhsa of breaking the fast while traveling was known for the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. So the companions knew the Prophet, the rukhsa of breaking the fast while you are traveling, right? So they are allowed to break their fast. Then Hamza asked the opposite question, can I fast? And of course, it's known that they can break the fast. So Hamza asked about the opposite question, can I fast in Ramadan while I'm traveling? Then the Prophet ﷺ said, if you wish, you can fast. If you otherwise, you don't fast. So thus he gave him the option to fast or break his fast while he is traveling. He gave him the option to fast or use the rukhsah. عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال كنا نسافر مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلم يعيب الصائم على المفطر ولا المفطر على الصائم. أنس رضي الله عنه said we used to travel with Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We used to travel with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and of course the meaning here is in Ramadan or while they are fasting. Then Anas saying about the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Anas saying the people who observe fasting didn't blame the people who break the fast, and the people who broke the fast didn't blame the people who observe fasting. The same option of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who gave him to Hamza al-Aslami radiallahu anhu. The Hamza The Prophet gave the option to Hamza radiallahu anhu, you can fast, you can break your fast, and the same with the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as saying, never a fasting person blamed a person who didn't fast, or a person who didn't fast blames a person who fasted or who observed the fasting.
So this ruksa is only during the journey, right? When we reach the destination, like we are supposed to be there for 2-3 days, and you are there, is this ruksa still stands, or you have to fast?
See, if you remember, we spoke about the ruksa also in for the traveler for wiping the khuf. See, a traveler will make use of all ruksas related to the traveler with all judgments. He will be considered as a traveler after he just passed his own town and forth and so on forth. So as long as he is called a traveler, that means he will make use of all rukhsas related to the traveler, from fasting, breaking the fasting, joining the salat, briefing the salat, or shorting the salat, wiping the sikhof, and so on forth. So, the next narration, all of these narrations, as we'll see inshallah, are all related to the fasting while travel. You will find some narrations says you should follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and break the fast. You will follow some other narration, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself fasted. You will follow us also. You will see other narrations in which the Prophet ﷺ gave the option to fast or not to fast. All of these narrations are mentioned. So the next narration is عن أبو الدرداء رضي الله عنه قال خرجنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في شهر رمضان في حر شديد حتى إذا كان أحدنا ليضع يده على رأسه من شدة الحر وما فينا صائم إلا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعبد الله بن رواحة رضي الله عنه. The Prophet Abu Darda رضي الله عنه said, we went with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on travel. In Ramadan, while it was severely heat, like 50, 60 degrees, like this, in harrin shadid, in a severe heat. حتى إذا كان أحدنا ليضع يده على رأسه من شدة الحر. From the severity of heat, the Sahaba put their hands on their heads. Why? To prevent sun strike. يعني from the severity of heat and sun, then the Sahaba put their hands on their head while they are traveling. And he said, no one of us was observing fasting except the Prophet ﷺ and Abdullah ibn Rawaha. From the whole army, from the whole companions, only two people observed fasting in this severe heat, Abdullah ibn Rawaha and the Prophet ﷺ. In the next narration, also related to the same topic, Jabir radiallahu anhu said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في سفر فرأى زحاما ورجلا قد ظلل عليه فقال ما هذا؟ قالوا صائم. قال ليس من البر الصوم في السفر. Jabir radiallahu anhu narrated that we were with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on a travel, and he said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Jabir say, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saw the crowd, a group of people, and a man who is shadowed with this group of people. That's a man sitting, and a group of people around him trying to make shadow around him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, what is this? They said, he is fasting. He's a fasting person. See, they were in a desert, in a fasting day in Ramadan, and he saw a group of people are just around one person who is sitting, and they are trying to make shadows to prevent heat and sun for him. He said, they said, he is fasting. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَيْسَ مِنَ الْبِرِّ أَصَّمُ فِي السَّفَرِ. It is not from piety or righteousness to fast on this travel. Yes. It is not a righteousness to observe fasting on travel. So this kind of, this is narration of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In Ramadan, all of these narrations are in Ramadan, while fasting was obligation, an obligation. Yes.
Our traveling is very comfortable.
Yes, excellent question. Even if traveling is nowadays comfortable in a plane, for example, still you are eligible to take the rukhsa, inshallah. You are eligible to take the rukhsa, but also you are okay to fast. Yeah. So. And for this specific narration, we can find why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it is not a kind of righteousness or of righteousness to observe fasting and travel. Why? In this situation, while the person was fasting alone and all companions were around him trying to shade him, while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it is not a righteousness to fast and on travel, while in another narration he said it is okay to fast. Excellent. This is the case. He feared the showing off for his followers. Imagine a person is sitting. Just because he is a traveling, all companions around him serving him. Imagine what Shaitan can use of this situation in his heart. So the Prophet ﷺ used to say, "Sadd al-zara'i," prevent the ways to the evil. Maybe it is not an evil in itself to fast and travel, because the Prophet himself in the previous, just the previous narration, he fasted alone with Abdullah ibn Rawaha on a very severe heat day. So here he said that because of blocking or closing the ways to evil, because he knows best the human being, and he knows best how Shaitan can make use of this in order to transfer the act of worship to an act of disobedience. So that the Prophet ﷺ said, لَيْسَ مِنَ الْبِرِّ الصَّوْمُ فِي السَّفَرِ. It is not a righteousness to fast on travel. And of course, this is not for the person himself specifically, it's for who would come after him. So the Prophet ﷺ didn't talk to a person himself. He is talking to the Ummah in general. Maybe the Sahabi is good or may not find Zariya or showing off. Maybe other people who will come after the Sahaba may find this feeling. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just blocking the ways to evil for his Ummah, for his nation. So that he said this. So no one can say that there is contradiction between the first one and the second one, because we understand the situation itself. Yes. We have to? Yes, if you have the rukhsa to break your fast in Ramadan and you break the fast, you have to replace it in another day after Ramadan. And you don't have any kind of burden or sin, because it is the rukhsa, it's allowed for you.
So since he's not fasting, he can be with his
Yes, yes, he can. Yes, he has a rukhsa. Yes, excellent question, Allah. He has a rukhsa, means he broke his fasting, he is not considered as fasting. And the expiation or the kafara is for whom? For the one who break his fast without any excuses. Without any excuses. So if the, if a person on travel and here is a small trick, but you shall not do this trick, okay? If you want to do so, then travel in order to avoid the kafara. But this is, as Ibn al-Qayyim, as a scholar said, this is like twisting the Sharia. يعني. So, إنما العمل بالنيات, of course. Of course, إنما العمل بالنيات. But this is the case, inshallah, that the traveler is okay to do anything that's related to the person who is not observing the fasting. Yes. Yes. If you are in a group and all of you are having the rukhsa or using the rukhsa, it's okay to eat with each other, yani, no problem. But if you are in a community, Muslim community, for example, in which there are other Muslims who are residents and observing the fasting, just respect the time of Ramadan. And even for the person who is considered as legally breaking the fast, if he is a sick, if he is a traveler, if she is in her periods or in her menses and so on and forth, try to respect the time of Ramadan, the time of the day of Ramadan. So don't eat openly, don't eat in front of a fasting person from the perspective of respect, not any other perspectives, of course. In another narration, which for the same narration, which is it is not a righteous act to fast and travel. In another narration, he said, or he continued, you have to observe the rukhsa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to you.
This
yeah. No. The previous one. Yeah.
Oh, the Jabir al-Hadith.
Yeah. You have to observe or you shall observe or you shall make use of the rukhsa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to you. That's why the scholar said that making the yukhsa or using the yukhsa is better than fasting. If you are a traveler, using the rukhsa is better than a traveler, especially if the travel requires an effort or requires physical power.
Using the rukhsa is more recommended because this is what Allah gave.
Yes, using the rukhsa is more recommended. Even if, subhanAllah, sometimes the acts of worship may be beloved to the person, maybe it's beloved to the person to fast. So that he will say, fasting is better than breaking the fast while you are a traveler, which is not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave you this rukhsa. And in another narration, I don't know the authenticity, maybe authentic or no, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُؤْتَ رُخَصُهُ كَمَا تُؤْتَ عَزَيْمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you to use his rukhsa exactly as to use his obligation or commands. So Allah loves you to use rukhsa and loves you to use also or to obey also the commands. So it is on the same because it is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
While performing Umrah, which one is
recommended?
While performing Umrah?
Yes.
We are considered traveler?
In Ramadan? Yes. Yes. If you are considered traveler in Ramadan while you are performing Umrah, then
it's recommended to make the rukhsa, to use the rukhsa. But at the same time, as we said, at the same time, it is not all. It is not the case in all cases. We can fast also, no problem. Especially if you are, like for example, the day of travel or the day of movements or like this, okay to use the rukhsa. But in other days, in the Umrah, for example, in the last 10 days of Ramadan, for example, you are still in the mosque. From dawn, from Fajr to Maghrib, you are still in the mosque. So, of course, you can use the rukhsa of breaking your fast, but it's better because you will not travel, you will not move, you will not do effort. It's recommended, of course, to make use of fasting also. If you are traveler to any place as a holiday, as a recreation, for example, it's okay to make use of the traveler rukhsa. Except in one case, which is if you are traveling to do haram, which is called safar al-ma'siyah, the travel of disobedience. You are traveling to do the haram, only to do the haram, to certain place to do the haram. In this case, you are not allowed to use any rukhsa, even fast, breaking the fast or doing the salah. You are not allowed to use any rukhsa. Why? Because your travel itself is a disobedience. يعني. Some people, may Allah forgive us and protect us. Some people are traveling to other countries in order to just go to the bar or to go to drink and so on, for gamble and so on and forth. So this is what we call safar al-ma'siyah, travel of disobedience, in which there is, of course, the one who travel for certain things, of course, yani, it's likely he is not praying also, yani, or he is not fasting. But in case he tries to pray or fast, he have to fast or pray because he is not allowed to take you or to make use of his rukhsa as a traveler. Something to say, he is unlawful traveler. Maybe. Yeah. Not Sharia compliant. Yeah, maybe. In another narration also related to breaking the fast and traveling, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu qal, كنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في سفر فمن الصائم ومن المفطر. As the same case. قال فنزلنا منزلا في يوم حار وأكثرنا ظلا صاحب الكساء فمن من يتقي الشمس بيده. قال فسقط الصوام وقام المفطرون فضربوا الأدنية وسقوا الركاب. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذهب المفطرون اليوم بالأجر. And سبحان الله, beautiful narration. Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه said we was in, was رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم on travel. Some of us was fasting. Were fasting, some other were not fasting. The same case, see, observe the all narrations in which the Prophet ﷺ used to travel with the companions. Even Anas also narrated a similar narration previously. He said that some of us were fasting, some of us didn't fast. This is the case, this was the case at the time of Prophet ﷺ. So he said, we went on a place in which it was tough and it was severely heat also in this day. So in this case, some of them were fasting, some of them were not fasting. And they, on this travel, they went to a place in which it was very tough and very heat at the same time. He says, وَأَكْثَرُنَا ظِلًّا صَاحِبُ الْكِسَاءِ. And this shows you how simple was the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, especially while they were traveling. He said that the most
one who have shade of us with the one who have a garment, who has kisa, who sahib kisa. Then he used his garment for as a shelter, as a shade. And some others who don't use enough garments, then they wear, as we said, they wear just putting their hands on their head. Then Anas radiallahu anhu said, فَسَقَطَ الصُّوَّامُ. Those people who were observing fasting, falling down. Alas. They couldn't do anything. They fall down. They become unconscious. Yani. From the heat and from the tough place was tough, he said that they fallen down. They couldn't endure fasting with the heat and with the toughness of place. He says, the person who didn't fast, then served the persons who fasted and fall down. Then they made the shadows and they gave them the drinks and so on. For they served them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this situation said, "ذهب المفطرون اليوم بالأد." Those people who broke their fast are the people who gone with the reward today. They gone with the reward. That means they took all the reward. The people who were serving the fasting people. Yeah, they took their reward. They gone with the whole reward. It means they took the reward.
Fasting.
Of the reward of the day. He said the reward of the day. Of the day in general. So from all of these narrations, we can find that fasting while traveling is an option for the traveler, as long as he is in a lawful travel for recreation or for an act of worship, for Hajj or Umrah, for example, or for Amal, for work, or for study, for anything is the lawful or recommended. Then he is allowed to fast or break his fast. And this is one of the rukhsah, and there was no difference or no blame between the people who fast or the people who don't fast at the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it should be the case also in our current time. If you saw a person who is not fasting, then it is okay because he is using the rukhsah. And if you saw a person who is fasting, also it is okay because he is using or he is feeling that it's okay, I can fast while traveling, as some other companions said. So if a person broke the fasting for travel, for being a traveler, then he have to replace this days, whatever. If it is one day or if it is the whole month, no problem. He have to replace it with another days after Ramadan. The question is it shall be consecutive days like the kafara? Or it may not be consecutive, and the correct opinion is it is okay not to be consecutive days. If he traveled for 7 days and he broke his fasting for 7 days, then after Ramadan he can replace with any day relevant to him or suits him, no problem, inshallah. The next question is, Can he do the six days of Shawwal before the missed days or before the replaced days? And the of course you know the difference of scholars, and some of them say you have to fast the wajib first, which is the missed days, before you fast the 6 days of Shawwal. Some other scholars said it's okay to fast the 6 days before the missed days. But in the sense of the Sharia, you can find that there are certain levels, right? Especially for the one who just have legal excuses for 1 day, 2 days, 7 days, like this. Then in the Sharia, there is certain levels. There is a level of wajib, and this is the level of sunnah, right? And the level of wajib have a higher priority, higher importance than the level of sunnah, and also have higher reward. So the salah of fard have higher level of importance and higher level of reward also than the salah of nafl, whatever the nafl was, or whatever the sunnah was. The same for anything. We have, if we categorize the acts of worship, we will find the fard is more important and is more in reward than the nafl or than the sunnah. If we observe the days of fasting, we will find that replacing the missed days in Ramadan is a wajib, is a wajib on you. And fasting the six days of Shawwal is a sunnah, not wajib. Then some scholars said he firstly shall do the missed days before fast the 6 days of Shawwal. Of course, if it is like 20 days or something like this, we can just understand that he will combine the two niyas of Shawwal and the days of Ramadan as a fard, and also he will just fast for 6 days, for another 6 days in another time. Scholars in this regard just says expect the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially if you have a legal excuse, like you have a disease, for example, or you were ill, for example, or you were in a period, for example, or menses, for example, you have a legal excuse. In this case, we have to understand this. In my personal opinion, humble personal opinion, you have to try your best to combine between the two things. You have to try your best to replace the missed days in Ramadan. If you are not able, then at the last 6 days of Shawwal, you can fast according to the Prophet ﷺ for the Sunnah, and then continue again after Shawwal in the missed days of Ramadan. That's why you can combine between the opinions and two opinions, and it will be the best if you completed the missed days and the 6 days of Shawwal at the same time. For example, someone missed 3 days in Ramadan. Then the best is to start with the 3 days after Ramadan, after the Eid, of course, after the day of Eid. Start with the 3 days, then start with the 6 days of Shawwal. This is the best solution in which you avoid the difference of scholars and different opinions, and you avoid everything. if you cannot, then observe as much as you can the wajib before the sunnah, as much as you can. If you can't observe the whole wajib, then observe as much as you can, then do the sunnah, then complete the wajib again, no problem, inshallah.
They say I did replace 3 days, and then I did shower, but only 5 days, and then I get my period. Can I the one day that I was supposed to face wajib is considered 6 days shawal. Even though the niyat is different.
I didn't understand. You did 3 days as the messed up days, right?
Yeah, I'm supposed to replace many more, but like you say, just try to do 3 days first, and then I try to do the 6 day shawal.
Uh-huh.
The niyat is different region.
Yes.
But before I complete the shawal,
uh-huh,
the 3 day I get my
message. Uh-huh. In this case, the Prophet said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Allah will reward you according to your niyyah, not your action. And this is in all actions, not only in the fasting, but alhamdulillah, Allah is the most generous. Yani. So He will give you according to your niyyah. Even in some other narrations, the Prophet ﷺ used to teach us that the person who is used to do a certain act, like for example, fasting every Monday and Thursday, or standing in night prayer, for example, for 11 rak'ahs. The person who is used to do this act, then out of his like option or out of his niyyah, stopped for a travel, for a disease, for anything. Who he was exhausted, for example, by the work, for anything he stopped. Allah, the Prophet ﷺ taught us that he will receive the full reward. The person who used to stand in prayer in Qiyamul Layl, then he slept one night, his reward continues without stopping. And this is one of the mercy or one of the aspects of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as I told you, just expect the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Expect the best. Yani not only some of the people were just counting the number of hasanat of reciting the Quran. He says that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Bism 3 letters, then Allah 5 letters, then ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So this is amount of letter multiple 10 times, then I will get this amount of hasanat. This is wrong. Why? Because the reward and the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond this. Is beyond Wallahu yudha'ifu liman yasha. And one of the great advices of Prophet ﷺ to one of his companions is, don't count. So that Allah don't count for you. لا تحصي فيحصي الله عليك. She was just counting. I will give so and so sadaqa. So I will give so and so sadaqa. He said, don't count. Just give. Don't count even the reward, because the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always beyond the specified reward. Always, yani not only one time or two times, always beyond this. It's according to the niyyah. So expect the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As long as you have the niyyah, you have the determination in your niyyah, you tried your best, then make sure, yani 100% that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not waste your niyyah or your determination or your efforts, inshallah.
Speaking of counting, if I miss 10 days in Ramadan, I still have to replace 10 days, right?
Yes.
So let's say just now I did 3 days and then 5 days shawal. So can I, that 3 days, can I minus 1 consider 6 shawal? So, you know, I have to do another 8 days this time. Or it doesn't matter, just fast.
Just fast.
Yeah, just fast.
I didn't understand your question. I have to understand first.
This time I fast 3 days, right? To replace 10 days period.
Okay, you have 10 days to replace.
Yes.
Then you fasted 3 days.
3 days, and then 5 days shower, I got my period.
Uh-huh.
So can I minus the first 3 days, so I minus 1, I consider I got 6 days shawal and only 2 days.
I think this is not your best, yani. I think this is not your best, yani. Maybe just as we said, that make the niyyah, make the determination, yeah, and try your best.
Doesn't matter, right? Just fast, I start.
Just fast.
Your fasting. Yes. Because I'm thinking, oh, your niyyah is not the same. You know, this one is replacing, this one is too much. So just fast Lausa, right?
Yeah.
Whatever number of days.
No. We have to be sure that this is a niyyah of fard and this is a niyyah of sunnah. We have to be sure about this. Of course, we can do two rak'ahs as two rak'ahs of Fajr and two rak'ahs of Qiyam al-Layl. No, we cannot. Why? Because of the difference.
So I just maintain 3 days as a replacement and then replace another 7 days in other...
Yes.
Even though my shower only 5 days.
Okay.
Okay.
And as I told you, just expect the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Some time ago, we were being told that I will say something that maybe you're going to laugh.
No problem.
They said that when we do our fasting, this is in olden days, okay, that you can combine the fardu, the wajib, with the nawafil. That means, like for example, in her case, this is in olden days, okay, that you can do your replacement plus your sunnah. At the same time, that means that one day you can do both. As long as you are not combining the wajib with the wajib, or you combine the wajib with the sunnah, it's okay. That's the understanding they were giving us back then. How do you comment on that? So it's like you fast the replacement day. Last
6 days of shawwal.
Yeah. 6 days of shawwal. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Together.
If we say that you are expecting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your niyyah is to fulfill your the obligation to replace the missed days, and you are expecting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of fasting these 6 months, it's okay. But if your niyyah is to combine between the 6 days and fasting, this is the niyyah itself. Then it's wrong. Why? Because we cannot combine between the wajib and the nafl at the same time. We have to be specific in our niyyah. As I told you, just try your best in fulfilling the wajib and expect the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous. Yes.
My question is quite in different context. During the life of the Prophet Muhammad,
sallallahu alaihi
wasallam, your family battles during Ramadan.
One of the situations that is recommended to break the fasting is during the battle. Okay. In any time, even the act of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions and even scholars just were showing off that they are fasting in this situation. They are not fasting in this situation, drinking or eating, or because the situation of a battle is different from other types of travel. So in the battle itself, it's recommended to break the fast. Why? Because this is a the near purpose is to be strong, because you are already in a battle. So this is the observation of the priorities of Sharia. If you are in a battle, that means you are in a situation in which you can make use of different rukhsas, of different things, in order to focus on what you are in, your current situation. You have any other question regarding travel and or kafara? Clear, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Yes. Not clear, alhamdulillah. Okay.
Is it okay to plan for work during Ramadan, like you travel for work?
Yeah, it is okay to travel for work, and it is okay also to break the fasting in this travel as a rukhsa.
What about other traveling that is very easy, like for fun?
It's okay also, as long as it is lawful, and as long as this fun is lawful.
And recreation or fun is lawful. It's not lawful, of course. It's not unlawful, of course. It's lawful, alhamdulillah. So, have any other question? So, barakallahu feekum. In next lecture, inshallah, we will start to cover the expiation or the replacement of other days of other fasting, inshallah, and all narrations related to this subject. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.